Episode 209 of Futures Radio Show, sponsored by CME Group, the world's leading and most diverse futures and options exchange. CME Group's markets help individuals and businesses around the world effectively manage risk. For access to free educational tools and resources for the active individual trader, please visit activetrader.cmegroup.com.
Every day, traders and investors dive in to tackle the ever-changing markets to find opportunity. Futures Radio Show is your number one source for answers to the questions that all market participants want to ask. Veteran futures trader Anthony Crudelli sits down with the most influential leaders and top traders in the industry. Now, here's your host, Anthony Crudelli.
Hey, everybody. Thanks for tuning in for this episode with Bob Iacino. Remember, new shows are posted every Monday and Thursday. You can subscribe to our show on iTunes and YouTube. If you're enjoying the show, please leave us a review on iTunes. Now, before I play today's interview for you, I want to give a shout out to the great sponsors of Futures Radio Show. CME Group, Trading Technologies, RJO Futures, and Top Step Trader. To learn more about these sponsors and the important things they are doing for futures traders, be sure to click on their logos on our website. Now, today I spoke with my friend Bob Iacino, who is the co-founder and chief market strategist at Path Trading Partners. And Bob is also the chief market strategist and head of research at TrendyTrade.com. I've known Bob for over 20 years, but funny enough, I didn't know much about his backstory and how he got involved in markets. So today's interview began with Bob telling us how he got his start in trading. Bob and I discussed trading myths, his technical and fundamental process. He gives us his thoughts on the Fed and ECB, his approach to trading crude oil and cryptos, and finally, he tells us his favorite tool for technical analysis. As usual, thank you all for listening, and please enjoy this episode. Bob, welcome to the show.
Good to be here, Anthony. Thanks for having me.
It's great to be with you today, Bob. Now, you and I, we go back to the spike days. I mean, it's almost 20 years ago when we first met. And I know that you have a great understanding of markets as I've watched you operate over the years. But even though we've known each other for many years, I don't know much about your background, how you got started. So I want to begin there today, Bob, if we could please. Tell us how you got your start in the futures industry.
It's kind of funny. I mean, I know a lot of guys that, you know, you interact with them every single day and then you're like, what do I really know about that guy other than I like him when he knows what he's doing?
Yep.
So my background's a little interesting. My family owned an Italian bakery in Chicago, and that was going to be my life's work. It was a small to medium sized company. And when I got out of college, my father brought in some investors to expand the business, to make it bigger for the family. And they actually ended up throwing him out. So obviously the whole family left and, you know, we all resigned. And I ended up coming down to the CME Group trading floor with a friend of mine who worked down there because I was unemployed. And he said, just why don't you come hang around with me for the day? And I did. And one day down there, I fell in love with it. I just walked around, begged for a job, found a guy who would give me a job for $500 a month. And my job was to get him his lunch, get him his coffee, and find another job. Those were the tasks he gave me. So that's what I did. And that's essentially how I started. From there, I ended up getting hired by a company called Nikko Securities. Nikko Securities merged with Smith Barney. I worked at Smith Barney for a while, left there, went to Commerzbank. And then after Commerzbank, ended up at Spike and then kind of went off on my own from there. So that's been kind of the 25 and a half year history of me from trading floor. I was in pits in the CME, pits at the old CBOT. I was in the 10-year, the bond, the yen, the euro dollar, and then a brief stint in the options pit in the euro dollars, and that's about it.
Yeah, that's pretty cool, your backstory. And you've covered the spectrum of the industry, and I want you to talk to us a little bit about what you're doing current day. I know that you're co-founder and chief market strategist at Path Trading Partners. And also, I know you're part of a startup because I saw you at the Startup Exchange.
Right.
And you're also the head of research at TrendyTrade.com. So talk to us about what you're doing with those two companies.
So I decided to leave the floor after September 11th. I saw this huge surge in volume based off of a terrorist attack. And it was one of my best years in the last bunch of years around that time. But I didn't like it. I knew I could tell things were changing. So I left the floor voluntarily in about 2004 to go off and remake myself. And from there, I became part a principal and part of an investment committee of a hedge fund of funds. And we traded futures and FX in that hedge fund of funds. Those were the managers we allocated to. So after that, we did that for about 6.5, 7 years, sold that. I went from there to a physical oil firm, an actual boutique physical oil firm that moved barges of crude oil. A lot of the times when I'm on TV now, you'll see me talking about crude oil because of that stint in the physical oil world, I kind of became known as a crude oil expert. It's actually the shortest amount of time I've ever spent on one asset. But from there, after that place shifted focus, I started Pat Trading Partners. Now, Pat Trading Partners, what we do is we do boutique white label analysis for firms that are large enough to need analysis, but not large enough to hire an analytical team. So we do price action and fundamental and geopolitical analysis for a couple of those people. Then I also do a bunch of speaking engagements. I do some things for E-Trade. I do some things for the CME Group themselves. Again, for a couple of these brokerage firms and IBs and institutions that are hiring speakers to do speeches. Almost exclusively, I talk about futures and futures options. So that's what I do now. And then within Pat Trading Partners, we have our own in-house prop trading firm where myself and my partner, Mike Arnold, use our respective experience in the hedge fund world to make sure that we manage trades and manage traders, again, within a very small world. Now, you mentioned Trendy Trade. That's the startup I'm a part of. I'm a principal and head of research at Trendy Trade. Trendy Trade is really aimed at a younger generation of traders. It's essentially a one-shop stop, and there's a free site and there's a paid-for site. It's a one-stop shop for information on what's going on in the markets right this second. And it's set up in sort of an infographic style, very easy to understand. And there we cover equities, cryptocurrencies, FX, futures, and basically everything you want to look at.
Yeah, very cool. No, I was very interested in Trendy Trade, and I thought that was a pretty cool idea. And I'm curious to see how that goes for you guys going forward. I want to talk a little bit about trading myths and expectations. You and I have been around a long time, and we both get a lot of people always asking us questions. Hey, what do you do for a living? And you know, for you and I, we're both probably like, well, we're traders, and you know, and then people either say a couple of things. Oh, it's glamorous, or it's easy, or they're like, oh, it's very stressful. But they never understand how much work goes into it. And like I said, you and I go back to the days of Spike. I know you were running a prop group there. You're still doing that. So you know what it takes to make it in this industry. You know, we don't work for a few hours a day and then go to the beach. I mean, maybe I golf a little more frequently than I did before, but that's a whole other story. But I know that you have a lot of strong feelings about trading myths and expectations. So talk to the traders out there about that.
I do. There's a couple of things, Anthony, and this is, again, you bring up the Spike days, and I think movies like Wall Street and The Wolf of Wall Street, and even The Big Short was one of the more accurate ones, I thought, because they showed the stress and people losing money and things like that. But like things like The Wolf of Wall Street kind of do a disservice to trading because they make it just seem like it's a bunch of guys throwing a Nerf football around and high-fiving when they make a good trade or a big sale, and it's not that. Most of trading, especially now, it's pretty solitary and it's pretty hard. So what I tell people all the time is that everyone that's listening to your show, Anthony, and everyone that ever listens to me speak can be a successful trader and active investor on some level. And it's that level that matters. And that's why I bring up the myths all the time. And that's why, you know, you were kind enough to ask me that question. I love that you set me up for this because there's a lot of myths and they're very public. Like, for example, buy low, sell high is a myth. As mentioned, I've been doing this 25 years. I can count on one hand the amount of times I bought the low and sold the high in anything. Normally, what you're trying to do when you're trading or even actively investing, and even long-term investors, you're trying to get a piece of a move. If something goes from 500 to 1,000, you're probably in at 700 and you're probably out at 850. You're not buying at 500 and selling at 1,000. You know, it's just impossible to do that. And another one is beating the indexes. That doesn't always mean you produce a higher total return. I tell people all the time that when we had our fund of funds, if somebody came into my office and said, yeah, our product returns 8 to 9% a year, and then about every 8 to 10 years, we lose 50%, I would have thrown them out. Well, that's buy and hold of the S&P 500. That's what that is. So when you want to beat the indexes when they're going down, if the index returns 21%, and you return 19%, you're doing okay. There's nothing to complain about there. But if the index drops 50% and you accepted all of that 50% and your retirement date is in that 50% stretch, you're not thinking. You did the wrong thing. So that's another one. Another one is short-term trading is less risky. Oftentimes, if you're trying to compete with high-frequency trading, you're in and out and you're getting killed. The thing to do now, in my opinion, is to shrink the size of your trades and extend the duration so that the high-frequency traders don't chop you up when they're getting in and out of things. Fixed stop losses, for example. I use stop losses, but it's the smallest part of my risk management system. My risk management system depends solely on the amount of money at risk and whether I can afford to put a particular trade on based on what price action is telling me. So those are some of the trading myths I talk about. Things like stop hunting, like the big firms are looking for your stop so that they can make money. Just simply not true. I worked at two of the largest banks in the world at the time I worked there. Never once did anyone go, hey, there's retail stops here, let's trade that way. It just doesn't happen. So no. There's a lot of trading myths that people who don't actually want to put the work in. You mentioned work. Trading is a trade. You can't become a doctor in 6 months. You can't become a lawyer in 6 months. You can't become an electrician or a plumber in 6 months. It takes work. So people think they're just going to go into this and be like, I'm going to learn a couple chart patterns, start trading. And then if you lose money, it's because the banks are looking for your orders. None of that stuff is true.
You know, hearing you say that people think that their stops are getting hunted. And for me, when you're having a bad day, you feel like you're being watched. It feels like you missed everything by a tick. You can't believe what's happening. This is crazy. But I want to talk about something that I think is very important that you mentioned, expectations. You know, I've been trading close to 20 years now, and I think that the one thing that when I look back on in my career and says, what's kept me around this long is adjusting my expectations. At the beginning of my career, I struggled and I started to make more money. You know, then my expectations got higher, but then I started to struggle again. Then I had to adjust my expectations on the way down, which is a very difficult thing for anyone who's, made significant money in this industry. And then you're like, okay, well now it's different. And always having to adapt to who I am and where I'm at as a trader in the market. And I think that for new traders, they have to come in and learn about themselves and have really low expectations at first. And I think that will give them the time to be around to identify when things are better for them.
Yeah, I think that's well put. I mean, do you want to be a successful active trader, or do you just want to tell people you buy stocks here and there? Both are okay, but manage your mindset around what you want to do, because to actively trade or to actively invest, it's very difficult to do part-time if you're trying to do it every day. You know, Anthony, you'll know this because you're from this area, but maybe some of your people who are outside the Chicago area won't understand this analogy. But there's a very inexpensive and very fun and very working class vacation called the Wisconsin Dells that are not too far outside of Chicago. It's not expensive to go there, but it's a lot of fun. You can take the family there. It's fun. Maybe you've saved up a certain amount of money to take your family to the Wisconsin Dells. I always tell people, here's a good example. Do I want to risk my Wisconsin Dells money for the chance to do Paris? And then my choice is going to either be Paris or no vacation at all. That's about expectations. It's like, no, I'm going to just do the Wisconsin Dells. It's about risk management and expectations.
Yeah, I love that example. I want to move on and talk a little bit about process, because you and I, we both come from the same background, and we know that process is critical. It's probably the most important thing in a trader's life. And technicals and fundamentals are the two things that people look at out there when they're trading. And I've seen you talk both fundamentally and technically. So talk to us about your process and your approach to trading.
So a little bit of inside baseball that I think you'll especially get a kick out of. I've been doing TV since 1999. And when I first started doing TV, I didn't know anything about the fundamentals. I was trading. I'd been trading 5 or 6 years at that point. But everything I did was based on price action. And now 95% of what I do is still based on price action. The first bunch of TV interviews I did, they would tell me ahead of time what the subject was, but not the questions. So I would go to the charts and I would say, okay, what's my technical opinion of the subjects they're going to ask me on? And then I would form a fundamental opinion that agreed with the charts. It's kind of changed now because I've been doing the fundamental analysis for so long that I will now go to mine and Mike's team and say, look, I think this is going to happen based off of these fundamental factors. Can you guys look at the charts and tell me if I'm right? And then I still have the ability to do my own technical and price action analysis, obviously. But the team led by my partner, Mike, is better at it than I am at this point. So if they say to me, no, your analysis is wrong in terms of where price is going to go, then we won't put the trade on. So essentially what I'm telling you is that we'll look at the various markets that we deal in, and those consist of S&P, NASDAQ, Russell, crude oil, gold, 19 different FX pairs, and then various individual stocks. We've got a list of about 50 stocks that we keep an eye on through our Stock Investors Blueprint, which is something else I'm involved in. And if the price action doesn't match, it doesn't matter what TV guy Bob thinks. We don't do the trade at all. So process starts with price action and essentially ends with price action. The only place fundamentals come in, and I hope I'm answering your question, is when I have a particular opinion on something.
No, you absolutely are answering my question, and I agree with that. I mean, like I said, we started in a similar place, right? So everything I did was price action. I was basically a market maker, is what I considered myself when I first started trading E-mini S&P. All I did was trade order flow all day long. Didn't care about anything else, right? That was all I did. Now, because I'm not nearly as active as I once was, I have learned to have a different mindset going into my executions. And basically what you're saying is what I agree with. Fundamental moves backed by technical analysis are more powerful. I mean, that is just it. So if I see something fundamentally that's going on and my charts support that, well, then I think that that move has got legs. It could be a bigger, more extended move. If the fundamentals are disagreeing with my technicals, then I'm like, okay, well, let's watch this play out a little bit. Maybe I'm not in a big hurry. And the perfect example, which I want to talk to you about next, is what's going on with interest rates, right? I mean, I'm not blind to this. I mean, if the Fed is raising rates, why am I in a big hurry for buy-in dips in the 10-year? I'm not. I'm gonna wait for short setups. I'm going to be more aggressive there. So I've heard you talk about this, Bob, the big divergence, the Fed normalization versus the ECB waiting for inflation. So give us your big picture thoughts, the fundamental backdrop, if you will, on this topic.
Sure. And I love this question. I've been talking about it for months now. When you look at the comments between the Fed and the ECB, and they're essentially both on a desired path of, let's just call it, removing accommodation, right? There's no longer an active quantitative easing program with the Federal Reserve in the U.S. They still have things rolling off the balance sheet, but they're no longer buying anything, no longer adding to the balance sheet. But the ECB is. So the ECB, when you see statements by the ECB, they're generally talking about waiting for inflation. When you see statements by the Fed, they're talking about normalizing rates. That is a very, very different condition that they operate under. So in other words, the Fed wants to normalize rates. I don't want to say regardless of inflation, but their focus is normalizing rates. So they're sitting around the table saying, can the market handle what we want to do? Whereas at the ECB, they're sitting around the table saying, is there enough inflation to do what we want to do? So it's almost like the Fed is saying, I'm going to go out, and if mom and dad yell at me, I'll deal with it. And the ECB is saying, do you think mom and dad will let me go out? So it's a very big divergence in the way they're looking at things. And that's part of why the dollar has rallied as much as it has. And if that condition does not change, you know, this is a recorded interview. So if that condition does not change, there's very little chance that the euro can scream above 119. Now, we've got a lot of Fed speak coming up. We've got a lot of ECB speak coming up. We've got meetings coming up. Things can change. But as long as they're both targeting that same thing, the U.S. is the stronger economy and can probably handle it. And the euro data has been decidedly mixed and probably won't give them the opportunity to do as much as they want to do.
Yeah, I love that explanation because it gives me the visual of what you're looking at. You are seeing what's happening fundamentally, and then you're going to go and look at your technical analysis, and you're going to wait for those trade opportunities as long as they stay on the message that you see them talking about, correct?
Right, exactly, exactly. That'll keep me looking to buy the dips in the dollar, sell the rallies in euro, U.S. dollar.
I want to talk about another market that I've seen you talk about quite a bit lately, and that's the crude oil market. And this fits right into with the technicals and the fundamentals, because on this show, I've had many, many traders talk about crude oil, and it seems that most of them are all technical-based, but use the fundamentals as well. So this is a, you know, perfect market to talk about where you're trading both technically and fundamentally. So talk to us about your approach to trading and executing trades in crude oil.
So crude oil is the same thing, right? I have a pretty intense fundamental background in crude oil. Crude oil, one of the great things about crude oil is prior to cryptocurrencies coming along, crude oil was the most volatile market there was. Now, in some cases, that scares people away from it. That draws me to it, right? Because we know we can find moves in crude oil. So the price action even becomes more important. And because crude oil, no matter what's going on at the end of the day, crude oil is a supply and demand market. There's not going to be a CEO scandal. There's not going to be an accounting irregularity. Crude oil is a supply and demand market. How much crude oil is out there and how many people are willing to buy it? So there's a couple of other things that come into play, like the curve and this and that. But essentially, we trade front month crude oil and some crude oil options. That's it. We look at the curve, again, because the fundamentals are fun. And when I go on TV, people want to talk about the crude oil curve. I look at the Brent crude oil spread as one of the things that comes into play. So what we do with crude oil is we do our price action analysis on WTI exclusively. Okay. And if we see, again, a price action pattern we like, we'll enter it either long or short. We do it in the big crude oil, but every once in a while, we'll do a longer duration trade in the mini crude oil at the CME, which is starting to become more liquid. There's still two tick spreads, but if it's a longer duration trade, we don't necessarily care. But the interesting part about crude oil is the things that everybody talks about in the news always go back to simply, does it affect the supply or does it affect the demand? So, for example, one of the things I'm looking at right now is the spread between Brent and WTI. It's widened as far as $12.60. What a lot of people don't know is the price of crude oil you see in the futures market is ex-transport, and WTI is U.S. crude, which is landlocked. It's mostly in the center of the country, decent distances from ports or storage or refineries, which are all in the Gulf Coast. So when somebody goes to buy WTI, they have to pay the shipping. It's called plus pipe. So they'll say, hey, we're doing WTI plus pipe, right? Pipe means either pipeline or rail cars or shipping, boats. Now, you can't take something out of North Dakota or Midland, Texas on a boat. It has to go on a pipeline or a rail car. There's a shortage of rail cars. So when you see that spread widen between Brent and WTI, Brent is near ports. Almost all Brent that's pulled out of the ground is close to the sea. So when WTI widens from Brent, that means now they can afford the transport to get it to the ports, and demand comes in WTI. So that's an interesting, that's just an example of what we're talking about when we look at supply and demand. So when I see that spread widen, I'll go to my guys and say, hey, do you have a short trade in Brent or a long trade in WTI that technically makes sense? Hopefully you have both, because that would be my preference, to be short Brent and long WTI when that spread widens. If they don't, again, we don't do it. Price action trumps everything for us.
Yeah, I mean, so bottom line is you're looking for confirmations. And yes, you're using these themes, we'll call it themes, that you're finding in the marketplace. And then the charts have to support them. Like you said, the price action trumps everything. And then you go in and execute.
Yeah. And I mean, I almost hesitate to call it confirmation, Anthony, because we won't do the trade without it. So technically it is confirmation, but it is technical analysis, and price action still is the lead thing for us. For example, we put on a trade recently in the Euro Japanese yen that I didn't have a fundamental opinion about. So it was purely a price action trade and it worked out. So, you know, everyone to keep in mind when they're listening to this, that if you don't understand what somebody like me is saying on TV, don't worry about it. No one's listening to me anyway. The charts do what they do. The only thing you can be 1,000% sure is correct is the price on your chart in front of you. The only thing you could be sure is last week, crude oil traded $65. That's a fact. No one can tell you anything different. Why did it trade $65? You can get 25 different opinions. Okay, but the only fact you know is price. We're not sitting in Goldman Sachs trading room, you know, getting, I hesitate to say that. We're not sitting in a big trading room getting an inside view or an inside sound on anything, right? Price action as individual traders is all we can know. So it has to be what you base your decisions on.
Last topic before we get into rapid fire. You mentioned cryptos. Just curious, what are your thoughts on cryptos in general?
So I love the space. They're fun to trade because, again, volatility, and they're difficult to trade right now. There's a, I mean, you know, I hope I can say this. There's a company called Blockfills that just launched recently, and I know the principles of it. And their white glove execution for high net worth crypto guys, you see how tight the spread can come when you talk to the guys at a shop like that to make it, they make it easy to open an account, blah, blah, blah. That will eventually trickle down to the individual crypto trader. Everybody loves blockchain technology. I don't think there's anybody left out there that's going to say they don't like blockchain technology. I believe cryptocurrencies will survive based on the efficiency of the blockchain. I just don't believe that we're ready to eliminate banks and middlemen at this point. I think that's more like phase four of it. So I think there will be a bunch of cryptocurrencies that do survive long term. I don't know if it's Bitcoin. I think Bitcoin might be MySpace. And I know there's probably a Facebook out there, and I'm just not sure which one it is. So I do buy and hold some of them. I trade most of them. If you go to our YouTube Path Trading Partners YouTube channel, you'll see my partner, Mike Arnold, does videos on those things every day. He's super into the active trading of them. So essentially, I'm a fan.
What is your process for trading cryptos?
The same with no fundamental input. I don't know enough about each one of those things. And, you know, they all have white papers, but who knows who wrote them? I don't know. If they're on a main exchange, like I'm much more, personally, I'm much more active in the ones where there's a futures contract, which now there's an Ether contract at the CME. So there's a Bitcoin and Ether contract, because then I know there's some stability to the product. I trust the CME's process in analyzing what's behind the actual currencies before they want to put a futures contract on it. But I'm not going to lie, I do buy and hold some of the obscure ones as well. But the process is exactly the same. We do top, you know, and I haven't gone into detail, but we do top-down analysis on everything. We start on weekly charts. We go all the way down to four-hour charts. And then we might enter trades on an hourly basis. All of it is top-down analysis. We do multi-time frame analysis. We make sure that the 1 week is not preventing us from doing a trade. Then we make sure the one day is not preventing us from doing a trade. Then the 4 hours is generally where we find the patterns, as long as the daily and weekly are out of our way in terms of negating those patterns. And then we dial down our entry to a 1 hour. And generally we're in trades from anywhere from a couple of days to a couple of weeks.
Yeah, I do the same thing. Daily, a little bit shorter term, I go daily 60 minute and then down to a 5 minute. But we talked a lot about fundamentals and technicals today, but I never asked you, what's your favorite tool for technical analysis?
That's interesting. So we really just use something called the R zone that's kind of ours, but it's not revolutionary. So the R zone is an 8 and a 21 EMA, all right? And so I don't have any particular indicators. I have things I like to look at. I mean, I obviously like to look at volume. Sometimes I like to look at changes in open interest. But my favorite actual, I hesitate to even call it a tool because it's our tool. It's a combination of the 8 and the 21 EMA. And we don't enter on crosses. We generally enter a trade after a first cross and a test of the R zone if there is also what we call a static R zone along with it. So in other words, if the 8, and let's just say that the 8 and the 21 crossed up. Okay, now obviously if that happened, the market's been running for a little bit. Now the market pulls back into the 8 and the 21, which is the R zone. I then look to the left and see if there's support and resistance that matches the area of the R zone. If there is, I will enter a trade based on some entry criteria and some risk criteria. So that would be a real simple way of putting it. There's obviously a lot more that goes into it, but that'd be something that like people that are listening to your show could put on their charts now and look at and refine for themselves. And then my favorite pattern is double tops and double bottoms, which we've actually adjusted quite a bit. We have what we call adjusted double tops and double bottoms, where there is a specific step-by-step criterion for what qualifies as a high probability reversal double. So those, again, are proprietary in-house things that we look at. So those are kind of my two favorites. And then lastly, there's something we call significant levels. And all that is much stronger support and resistance than normal support and resistance.
Oh, I love the simplicity. Thank you for sharing that, Bob. Now, sure. We have rapid fire questions if you're ready for those.
Absolutely.
All right, everyone. Our rapid fire segment is sponsored by Trading Technologies. Access the global markets from virtually anywhere with TT. They are the world's fastest commercially available futures trading platform. And now you can trade cryptocurrency spot and derivative markets side by side. For more information, please visit tradingtechnologies.com. Bob, first question. What trader has influenced your life the most and why?
Wow. So I met him a couple times, but it was T. Boone Pickens. And I don't even know if we can call him a trader. He was my man crush. So I know we're doing rapid fire here, but he one time did something where he took a bunch of his earnings for the year and reinvested them back into his university, which was Oklahoma State. And then Oklahoma State put that money right back into his hedge fund. And I just thought that was genius.
What was one of the hardest things that you've had to overcome in trading?
The first time I started trading for myself, I lost over $90,000 in 7 months. And it was hard for me to realize that whether I was smart or dumb didn't matter. The market was always smarter.
How has your trading evolved over the years?
Well, obviously from pit to electronic, but you know, even though I've been doing this for 25 years, I still kind of get that ego and I get this idea that when the trade works, I'm smart, and when it doesn't, I'm dumb. So that's been the biggest evolution for me, is to realize that that's not true. I don't attach my personal worth, my view of myself in the mirror, into whether a trade made or lost money. I attach my personal value for the day into whether I did the correct trade. And the correct trade often has nothing to do with the result of that trade. It's how well you followed your process.
What's the number one resource you spend your time on?
Well, I listen to your show a lot, but to be honest, I hate to say it because this sounds like I'm promoting, but I'm not. I spend a lot of time on trendingtrade.com. But otherwise, because I'm able to dial down to what I need for my TV spots. But outside of that, I use the CME Group website quite a bit with their Fed Watch tool, because that's important for a lot of my trades. And then obviously my charting platforms are overall everything to me.
What's your favorite book about trading or the markets?
Trading in the Zone, by far. Trading in the Zone is great because most people struggle more with psychology than anything else. I also like Market Mind Games. Those are two I'd recommend.
What's your favorite movie or TV show about trading or the markets?
Without a doubt, The Big Short. The Big Short was my favorite because, by the way, The Big Short taught a really bad lesson, which is continue to add to a loser. But it was fun to see all of the scummy stuff that goes around in the background. And just for the record, I have never and still do not associate with anyone with these bad intentions in our business, which includes you. So I appreciate you having me on.
What's the best piece of advice that you've received about trading or the markets?
A guy that I worked with on the trading floor when I was about a year and a half in, and it annoyed me at the time, but he constantly repeated to me, you have to do the hard homework. You can't think you're just going to get this stuff. You have to do the hard homework. And I rolled my eyes every day. And now, 25 years later, I find myself doing the hard homework.
Now, if you can give a piece of advice to the new people interested in getting involved in trading, what would it be?
It'd be twofold, Anthony. It would be, number one, you actually can do this. You just may not be able to do it at the level that you think when you're going into it. So, for example, people like to take up golf, but they don't try to become Tiger Woods right away, or they don't say, I'm going to become Tiger Woods in 6 months. Manage your expectations of what trading is in relationship to your personality and your personal situation. And then the second thing would be, don't think that because you lost money, it was a bad trade, or because you made money, it was a good trade. If you get rewarded for bad behavior, in other words, if you put on bad trades and you make money, you will end your trading career and you will blow up 100% of the time without fail. And you can quote me on that. You need a process that you follow that takes you in the path of high probability trading. And with that, you'll lose some and you'll win some. But if you follow your process, you can look in the mirror and say, I did the right thing. And that's the most important thing.
Last question for today, Bob. If you weren't involved with trading in the markets, you'd be doing what?
Owning an Italian restaurant, without a doubt.
Oh, man, I could smell the veal parm right now. Where can people find you on Twitter, and give us your websites to check out?
So Twitter, they can go to Bob @Iacino, which is IACCINO. If you can't find me there, go to @CMEActiveTrader, because I do a Twitter video for them 6 times a week. So they'll send it out and you could find my handle on there. I know sometimes people can't spell my last name that easily. So either one of those, you'll find me if you're looking for me. Feel free to message me. I don't cut off the message thing on Twitter either. And then you could go to pathtradingpartners.com. And if you're interested in learning any more about the stuff I talked about here, there is a store tab there. We don't promote courses, but we do have a couple that are for sale. We're really not an education site. We just put those up when we got the website launched. I think we sold 10 courses last year. We don't really care about that. So if you want to buy them, buy them. It's okay. And then trendytrade.com is another place where you'll find me. Again, I'm the chief market strategist and head of research for that. I do a weekend preview for the CME group every Friday on Twitter. And then I do a second one of those on the trendytrade.com website on the Monday of the following week.
Hey, everybody, I highly recommend you go to any one of those websites or Twitter handles to find Bob. He's a no-nonsense guy who knows a lot about trading and markets. Bob, thank you so much for coming on Futures Radio Show today.
Glad to be here, man. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for listening to Futures Radio Show. If you have any questions or comments for myself or my guests, please visit futuresradioshow.com and sign up to be a premium member for free. If you enjoyed the show, don't forget to leave us a review on iTunes.